And there he finally sits, the Forge World Greater Demon of Nurgle, the Great Unclean One, a model I've been coveting for half of my life at this point. Good God. I mean, I was 13 when I started this hobby, and it wasn't too long after that that I discovered Forge World, and it was this alongside the Keeper of Secrets model that really left an impression on me, and I've been coveting ever since. I just never could justify the price. It demands an outrageous price, but thankfully I was able to find it at half price on eBay, and here he sits. And looking at the model, you know, he has aged like fine wine. It's thinking back to the time when he came out, the official Great Unclean One model was like one third of his size, and it looked kind of crappy compared to him. And you know, and these days it's kind of funny that the official Games Workshop plastic Great Unclean One models are so clearly modeled after the appearance of him, when at the time he came out, he was like a special, like Titanic, like named character called Scabathrax the Bloated, who, you know, on tabletop demands as much of an outrageous price in points as this model does in actual currency. You know, and it's kind of OP. I'm not planning on using him as a Scabathrax, but as a regular Great Unclean One, and I just love his appearance and the nostalgia factor and finally getting my hands on it, and also having an army that has a heavy theme on greater demons, him being my fourth Great Unclean One. I really need some variety in the appearance section, and he is here to provide. I'm firstly going to start with cleaning the model. I'm going to start scratching, scraping, and filing away, and the main body doesn't really have all that much to scrape and scratch and file away, except for the area underneath his arm there. That's been kind of plugged, and I need to unplug that area. Besides that, there's, you know, the sword arm has some cleaning up to do, and also the horns are pretty, you know, need to clean that stuff up. And knowing how, you know, Forge World resin is when you start to file it into a fine powder, and how dangerous that is to your health when you breathe that in, I'm coming in prepared with some protection. And also, you know, once that's done, I'm gonna start gluing some of the bits onto the main body, except for the sword arm. I'm going to use basically paint this as a separate piece and later on attach it, because it's gonna come here and it's going to rest so closely to his body that it's gonna cover up a lot of areas that are gonna be very difficult to get to with a paintbrush later on. So I'm gonna use that, attach that later, and if it needs some green stuff, then it's gonna need some green stuff. What can you do? And of course, before I start to paint anything, I'm gonna get me some soapy water, and I have a toothbrush ready to scrape it clean, because these Forge World models have a kind of powdery release agent on their surface that's kind of invisible to the naked eye. And if you just start painting it, the powder might come off one day, and all the paint on top of it is just gonna fall off, and you're gonna have a really bad day. So yeah, I'm gonna get to that. And as a little mention that I forgot to point out earlier, this model did not come with this base. I'm not sure if it comes with this size base these days, but buying it off of eBay, it came with a base of this size, and putting him on it, you know, it's kind of, he's kind of coming over it, and kind of, yeah, it's kind of a tight fit. So I wanted him to have the same size base as the other Great Unclean Ones in my army have, for uniformity's sake, and also because I think he looks better on a bigger base, and because the rules kind of demand it, because you're measuring distances off of the edge of your bases, and if you have a smaller base, you can fit him in tighter spaces, and also with a larger base, there's more space place for your enemies to come and fight you in close combat and whatnot. So it's only fair to get the bigger base. But yeah, I'm gonna go and do all the things I described earlier, just start scraping and washing and cleaning. And I'm also going to give him the first base coat of paint through spray painting and a little bit of brushwork. And I'll be back in a sec. And there we are with the assemblage and the base coating all done. Now this guy was pretty easy to put together with all the horns and antlers and tentacles and all that. The only spot that gave me trouble was the tongue. And the tongue is supposed to coil all around the sword blade once the sword arm is attached. And all the individual tongue pieces were a pain in the ass to put together, because once they were just glued together, they looked like jigsaw puzzle pieces. They looked kind of inorganic and not very smooth. The parts where they came together were kind of, they had gaps and edges and all that. And I tried to save it with some green stuff, but you know, my green stuff usage skills are below average at best, so it looks kind of mangled up and not very pretty, but I'm hoping that not only will the sword blade kind of obfuscate a lot of my misdeeds, but it'll also get kind of cleared up with a lot of painting and a lot of different kinds of goo and ooze and gore effects that I get to use later on in the painting process. Now, this model's skin pigment has been base coated the exact same way I do with all of my Nurgle Demon models, which is first to base spray it with Aberland Sunset, and then use, of course, the paint from the pot to fix places here and there that the spray didn't quite catch. And then I go through the kind of belly area, the underarm, the inner thigh, the face, and all that kind of underside with Rakkar flesh. Now, the next stage I'm going to go for is dry brushing the Rakkar flesh with some palette witch flesh, which is going to, of course, make it more three-dimensional and make it have much more of a, have some highlights and lower, deeper recesses there that are going to be emphasized. Then I'm going to glaze over it with two layers of Athonian camo shade, which is going to give it a greenish tint, while the kind of Rakkar flesh and palette witch flesh is going to kind of glow from underneath it to give it kind of a gray tone, so that it doesn't look like goblin or orc skin. It looks not perhaps like rotting skin, but it looks different. It looks a little different. Yeah, a little unique, I guess. It's kind of like making rotting flesh, but making it kind of go overboard to where it doesn't really look realistic anymore. And I've really liked how it's looked with my demon units. And then I'm going to give it a light dry brush on selected areas with Nurgling Green to kind of emphasize that green a little bit. And on the yellow skin, I'm going to dry brush the Everland Sunset with Hexus Pale Sun, which is going to be a pretty extreme highlight to dry brush on it, but I'm going to glaze over that with Agrax Earthshade, and once that's done, it's going to be very brownish, so I'm going to have to come back with a glaze of Lamenter's Yellow. And this is how the Nurgle Demon skin is done in my army, and I'll get back to you once that's done. And that's the skin pigment stage all complete. And the biggest lesson I learned about painting this model from this stage is just how textured its surfaces truly are. If you compare him to the official Plastic Games Workshop Great Unclean One models, those models, even though they're covered in fat rolls, each individual fat roll is actually quite smooth. So when you're dry brushing them to get some highlights, or you're putting washes on them to get some shadows, you get quite thick and smooth lines of light and shadow. With this guy, I think the smoothest areas on his person are his entrails and maybe some of the blubber that's coming from underneath his skin there. But the rest is just comprised of so many tiny, tiny little cuts and crevices and wrinkles that the kind of shadows and the highlights consist of multiple little lines rather than big, thick, singular ones. And it still makes the model look good, but it's just something to keep in mind so that it doesn't catch you by surprise. I finished also the sword, and since it was so simple to make, I decided to go on and get it done at this stage already. I spray painted it with some lead belcher, and I painted the hand the same way as the rest of the skin, and then I made the straps on the sword with storm vermin fur, and then I washed all over it with some Agrax Earthshade. And once that was done, I highlighted the straps by mixing some storm vermin fur with some pallid witch flesh to make a lighter version of the storm vermin fur, and then I highlighted the sword blade with some iron breaker. And since that was quite an easy process to do, I then decided that the next stage that I'm going to be going for is going to be the longest and the most challenging stage of all, which is going to be just about every detail on the character. I'm going to paint all of the horns and bones by first undercoating them with Xandri dust, then putting another coat of Ushabti bone, then washing over them with Agrax Earthshade, and finally, after dry brushing them a little bit again with Ushabti bone, I'm going to give some extreme highlights with Screaming Skull. And that's what's gonna go to the antlers, to the horns, to the teeth, and all of those things. Then I'm going to go to all the wounds, and all the wounds are going to be base coated with White Scar, and once they are clear and shining white, I'm going to give them two layers of Athonian Camo Shade, and after that, I'm going to layer on top of every smooth highlight surface of those wounds, like the entrails and some of the edges and the like, with Screaming Skull. That's also going to go for the tongue, as well as all the entrails and all of those kind of things. The blisters are going to be done very simply with Screaming Skull, and depending on whether it's blisters on the yellow skin or blisters on the green skin, I'm going to put a dollop of either Agrax Earthshade or Athonian Camo Shade on them, and then put a little highlight back with Screaming Skull. Then the only thing left in this stage to do are the fingernails, and the fingernails are going to be done with Skaven Blight Dinge, and then highlighted with Storm Vermin Fur. And once all of this is done, I'm going to attach the sword hand to his wrist and get back to you before I go to the final stage. Whew, that's the detail stage finally complete, and I have to say, I'm pretty glad with how things turned out, especially with the tongue. Now we will enter the final stage, which will start with the base. And first, I'm going to cover his base with human skulls. And after those are glued in, I'm going to paint a layer of Eshin Gray on all of the surfaces, and then cover that up with Astro Granite Debris. Now, if you're painting smaller bases, like the bases of regular infantrymen, a single layer of Astro Granite Debris is just fine. But with a base this size, if you just paint a single layer of it, it'll look too neat. It'll be too kind of driveway gravel looking. So I'll need to put more than one layer just to create more randomized clumps of gravel here and there. After that, I'm going to wash all over it with Nuln oil and dry brush it with Celestra Gray. The final thing to do for the base is going to be the rim, which I'm going to paint with Storm Vermin Fur. Now, once all of that is done, I get to put on a coat of varnish for this guy, and I'm going to use the Munitorum varnish spray from Citadel, which I've kind of become accustomed to these days. It'll protect the model from a lot of wear and tear and the ravages of time and transportation and all that. And especially since I keep these models in a display cabinet, they can collect some dust and the like, so a layer of varnish is a good idea. And after that, I can then go on and put on some art coat, which is a kind of glossy, glistening layer of varnish on all the wounds and the tongue and the mouth and all of those surfaces. I'm, however, going to not put them on the blisters because I feel like if I go overboard with it, then the glistening is not gonna feel all that special. If everything glistens, then it's just a normal thing. You know, it doesn't feel special. Once that's done, it's time for the very last thing, which is going to be Nurgle's Rot. Now, Nurgle's Rot is a pretty tricky technical paint that I had to kind of suffer my first great unclean one through before learning really how it's used, because a lot of the tutorials online just tell you you can put a layer on it of it on top of any kind of wound or anything like that, and a lot of the surfaces that it covers will shine through it in this kind of transparent way. But what I learned is that when the paint is wet, it looks 10 times as transparent as it does when it's dry. When it's dry, if you cover the entire wound with it, the entire wound is just going to turn just matte green. So you have to be really careful with it not to ruin a paint job you've put in a lot of effort to, you know, by just covering it with a layer of green. So what I'm gonna do is that once all the wounds glisten, I'm going to put some Nurgle's Rot on the kind of bottom edges of those wounds so that it looks like it's seeping out and coming kind of over the edges and overboard, but not covering everything that's visible so that it becomes invisible due to that coat of paint. So we're about to go to the final presentation of this guy, so it's time to say the magic words, Klaatu Verata! And with that, he is finally complete. Now, looking at him with all of that paint on him, all of that glistening, gooey goodness on him, I'm feeling kind of good about him. I'm feeling kind of proud about this entire project because I had a plan, I executed that plan, and the results were better than the image I had in my head when I first took this guy out of his packaging. And this project itself has been kind of a journey because this guy came with a lot of emotional baggage due to the nostalgia factor and due to him being my very first Forge World model I ever tackled. And also because there were some bumps on the road with the tongue and other things that we persevered. And I'm going to have to walk back on little something, which was all about Scabathrax the Bloated. A friend of mine just challenged me to a 3,000-point game, so wouldn't you know it, he will be fielded on the field of battle for the very first time as Scabathrax the Bloated. But fear not, he is not coming alone. He is bringing with him his greater demon, his great unclean one friends, and together as a team of four, we will persevere, we will gain victory. Thanks everybody for sticking by the video and leaving all the likes and comments and the like. This has been awesome.